Hello, Lila. I hear you grew up in a family with 8 kids. Is it reason why you are so engaged in defending human life?
Well, I think having 7 brothers and sisters definitely is something to appreciate, because they're every life, I wouldn't not want to have one of them, obviously. But every child, whether they're from one child in a family or there's 10 children in the family, is precious and has a human right to life. And that right should not be violated. That's a right that should protect them from abortion and from any other assault.
Once you said life is so good, why do you think so? And what about children who don't feel life is so good, who are not so loved?
The solution to problems that we face is never to kill. So you wouldn't take a 2-year-old boy and say, oh, his life is difficult, so let's kill him. The solution is never to kill. We can do better than this. Women deserve better than this. Our children have human rights, and they deserve better than this. Society will flourish if we respect human life and say, let's find ways to solve the problems that we face instead of use killing as an answer.
Do you start every speech with prayer, with Holy Mass maybe? Like here in Split? Yeah.
I'm Catholic. I'm a Catholic convert 5 years ago. But we have, in the pro-life movement, no matter your religion, no matter your worldview, you can come around together around the common creed of human rights. This understanding that there are human rights that should not be violated. And the first human right is the right to life. So no matter your religion, no matter your philosophy, no matter anything, you have to respect that fundamental human right for a civilization, a society to be founded upon it.
What is the reason why you are convert to Catholic? Yeah, you were Protestant, I suppose.
It's true, yeah. The Eucharist. Coming to understand intellectually the reality, the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist and the teaching behind it, and then wanting to be able to receive the Eucharist and Christ in that way.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Lila. And your impression about Croatia?
I love it. It's beautiful. I hope I can return. But I'm delighted to be here to talk about something that is of the most crucial and burning importance for Croatia, for the United States, for really the whole world. It's a question that goes to the very heart of who we are as people, as nations. It's a core question of faith. It's a core question of human rights. It's the question of how we treat the weakest among us. And first off, for those people who are of faith, anybody here who is Catholic maybe? And first off, I have to mention, I think it was mentioned earlier, I became Catholic 5 years ago, and it gets better every day. But, and I'm so grateful for it. Thank you. I'm so grateful for my faith and our Catholic faith, our universal Catholic faith. But this question of how we treat the weakest is crucial, because the first human right is always life. Without life, you cannot experience or enjoy any other human right. So that first right must be protected. It is crucial. And in any civil society, the most pressing question becomes what to do with those who cannot care or protect themselves. You see, laws are created for the weak, not for the strong. They're created to help guide our consciences and how to treat those who do not have power over us. And I want to tell you a story of how these things began to make an impact on me when I was very young, many years ago. I'm not very young anymore, of course. I was only 9 years old at the time. Very beautiful coastlines here, like here in Split. But I was 9, and it was one rainy day, and I was looking for a book to read in my parents' home. Long story short, I found a book. My dad has a lot of books. My mother complains they're in every room of the house. And on the bottom of a shelf, I found a book called A Handbook on Abortion. And it had a very serious-looking woman on the cover, and I was interested, so I opened it up. It fell to the center where there were these images. And in horror and shock, I closed the book and I pushed it away. I didn't want to keep looking at this image that I was looking at. And gathering up a little bit of courage, I brought the book back and I looked, and I was staring at the image of a child. Some of you may have seen an image like this. This was a child in the first trimester with newly forming arms and legs and a newly forming little face. And this child had been the victim of a first trimester suction curettage abortion. And my heart at 9 years old was cut, and I thought, is this real? Is this really happening? They say that children sometimes know it best. They're very honest. And I knew right away that this was wrong. After seeing that image, I wanted to learn more. Why was it happening? How was it happening? I learned that there are over 1 million abortions happening every year in the United States, over 3,000 a day, and that since 1973, somehow, Supreme Court justices, judges, had made this a right, a so-called right. Within 10 miles of my childhood home, where I grew up safe and loved, there was a Planned Parenthood abortion clinic, open for business for abortions on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays, killing over 30 children a day, almost 100 children a week. And I realized that though I had been safe, we are safe. We survived abortion in our countries, our generations. There are children who were not safe and who have not survived. I came across the writings of Blessed Mother Teresa, you know her, the little nun from Calcutta. And Mother Teresa, whenever she had the opportunity, had very strong words to say. And one time to a group of politicians, many of them in support of abortion, she said these words: "The greatest destroyer of peace in the world today is the cry of the innocent unborn child. In a nation where a mother can kill her own child, what is left but for you and for me to kill one another?" Mother Teresa is a Nobel Peace Prize winner, an expert on peace. She says the greatest destroyer of peace in a society is the killing of the littlest one. And we want peace in our countries. We want peace in the US, we want peace in Croatia, right? And we want to rise above dark legacies that are behind us. In the United States, we have slavery. We have the ill treatment of minority groups. And here in Croatia, you are rising above the dark legacy of communism. And what did communism give you in the 1970s? The legalization and the killing of the littlest Croatian, of the littlest one. You see, how we treat that child is going to define our societies. In the United States, when I was a teenager, I began live action because I wanted to give my life for something more than myself, and this was the most burning cause. And I will switch issues and become another kind of activist or advocate for another cause if you can show me one that is more important than this. We are at a crossroads between the culture of death and the culture of life in our nations. And in the United States, as I began to do education, I began to see how widespread this culture of death, this death culture was. You see, when you open the door to abortion, you're not just killing a child. You're destroying souls. You're sowing violence in the most intimate human relationships. You're destroying the family. And the family is the first unit, the most fundamental block, building block of any society. I want to share with you just a couple quick things about the culture of death in the United States and what will happen, what can happen in Croatia if you do not turn the course. And I share this with you with a very heavy heart because my country, with all its power and its claim to leadership and sometimes its holier-than-thou attitudes, we have been exporting abortion overseas for years now and exporting the death culture, the sexualization, the sexualization, objectification of women, the breakdown of marriage and the family, pornography, the abortion of children. And all of these things I want to ask your forgiveness for, because I'm proud of my country, but of these things I am not proud. And they break my heart and many other hearts, because wealthy Americans like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and Warren Buffett are literally spending billions of dollars on abortion in the US and internationally. And powerful politicians in the United States are crafting policies about how to pressure groups like the United Nations and the European Union to accept the death culture. So for 7 years now, myself and my organization has been exposing the death culture. And in this process, we have documented that, first off, this is an over $1 billion industry a year in the United States. And abortion in the United States is legal in many places through all 9 months. And they claim, the abortionists and the abortion industry claims to be for women, pro-women, but it's a lie. We've documented the abortion clinics helping sexual abusers and using abortion as a cover-up for the crime of abuse. We've documented lies and manipulation told to women going in to seek accurate medical information. We've documented how abortion clinics were founded by an ideology of eugenics and racism. And Margaret Sanger, the founder of Planned Parenthood, was a eugenicist. And eugenics is this idea that some people should never be born because they are the wrong race. They are not the best breed. And Margaret Sanger said the best thing that a large family can do for one of its infant members is to kill it. And she was pen pals with some of the architects of the Final Solution in Nazi Germany. And she's the founder of International Planned Parenthood. And every year in the U.S., we give a Margaret Sanger Award to a leading politician. And Hillary Clinton received one last year, which is a shame for all women, because it's against everything that empowers a woman. A woman doesn't walk into an abortion clinic or a hospital seeking abortion feeling powerful. She often feels depressed and alone. But society says, no, this is good for you, this is good for your future. But that's a lie, and there is so much silent grief that is carried, wounds that are carried by women all over Croatia and the United States. And those women need and deserve healing, but society says, no big deal, abortion is no big deal. It's not just a human rights abuse. It's not just leaving behind a wounded mother and a wounded father and breaking down the family, but it's restricting that society from the peace that all societies want. This work can be very tiring for your heart and in every way, because it's so you're facing so much violence, so much killing. And there's a lot of inertia. People don't care. I was very inspired in Zagreb because the 40 Days for Life campaign, young people outside the hospital where they commit abortions praying for 40 days. But it's not easy to do this because people look at you and say, are you crazy? It's good to be a little crazy for the right thing. It's good to step out in faith. And when you look at history, the people who changed the course of history for better were the ones who stepped out with courage. But sometimes I think, you know, what's the point? We still have so many abortions in the United States. How do we make an impact? And I come back to this thought that even if all of this work goes for one life, it's worth it. And this is Jesus Christ our Lord giving his life on the cross, even for one of our lives. That's how much he loves. And Jesus says, whatever you do to the least of these, you do it to me. But whatever you don't do to the least of these, you don't do it to me. He's taking on radical solidarity with the smallest one, with the weakest one. So when we love him in the disguise of the littlest one, hidden in the womb, we are loving Jesus. But the story I was going to share very quickly is I received an email last month. And these sorts of emails, well, I receive hundreds of emails every day, but this was a very special email. And it was from a woman who said that she was going to have an abortion. But she was online and she came across some of our videos. And she said when she saw one of the videos, she immediately decided she couldn't have the abortion. She attached a little picture of her newborn daughter named me. And when I get an email like that, I think my little life is not enough to give. So I want to encourage you here in Croatia that you can overcome the culture of death in your nation by sharing the truth one person at a time. Through our prayers and our crying out to God for mercy on our nations. Through getting active and saying, what can we do? Getting together in a group, strategizing, how can we reach our community? By refusing to vote for a single politician unless he stands for all human rights. You see, this burden in my country and in yours, it rests on our generation's shoulders. And it's up to us to change the course of our nation's histories. The contraceptive mentality is responsible for abortion all over the world. What has happened is in our societies and our cultures, we have separated the procreative from the unitive in sex. So sex is taught by the media and in our cultures, and even sometimes by teachers to children, that it's just this biological function or an act, and it is something recreational that is not about fidelity, marriage, or children. This isn't fair because it rejects a holistic understanding of sex that God has as a plan for sexuality. And if you have a culture that says it's my right to have sex without children, then you need abortion. Because even with the best contraceptives, you can still get pregnant. And I have talked with many girls and heard the stories of many more who were on the pill or who thought they were doing safe sex, but there they are at the abortion clinic because they're pregnant. Women who have had abortions, many of them suffer from trauma. And this is an important area for the pro-life movement to say, how can we address these problems to help these women heal? And in the United States, we have ministries or nonprofits devoted to providing the healing emotionally, physically, mentally, spiritually to women who have had abortion because of the trauma that they endured so that they can recover. And men often need this healing too, because for every child that's been killed, that child had a father. And so there should be healing for the father as well. It's this misunderstanding that sometimes it is licit, it is allowed to kill a child. And the Catholic Church has never said that the child is more valuable than the woman or the woman is more valuable than the child. But the Church, of course, gives freedom to the woman and her husband, if she is pregnant, to choose medical treatments even if they might, as an accident, as an accident, not as a consequence, hurt the child during the pregnancy. So for example, I'm a woman and I say have a cancer and I'm pregnant. I can accept chemotherapy even if it hurts my child. That's not abortion. But it's never licit to directly commit an act in order for the purpose of killing that child. It's never allowed. And it's never medically necessary. Abortion is never a medical treatment for a sickness, for a medical condition. Until very recently in Ireland, they had no abortion for any reason. And several hundred medical professionals signed the Dublin Declaration, declaring that it is never medically necessary to commit an abortion. So there are certainly powerful corporate interests, like at Google, that have done things to censor the pro-life position. And often it's because the bosses or the owners of the corporations can be extremely pro-abortion. And it's usually because they are eugenicists or population control ideologues. So there's different reasons for this, but it's powerful ideologies with powerful money funding the abortion all over the world. So the Google, it's a little different there. I mean, but I know some of the people involved can be are very wealthy and very powerful, so sometimes they use their companies, like Warren Buffett, and the money from it for abortion. Yes, so media is so powerful because in live action we have the biggest social media presence for the pro-life movement in the U.S. One tweet, one Facebook post, one news article on a blog can be very powerful in changing the heart or the mind or touching the heart or the mind of even one person. And sometimes the mainstream media doesn't want to report these things, or the politicians are against you, or the educational structures will not, you know, the faculty or the professors will not say the truth. So using new media, social media, is a powerful way to get the truth out. And it's the same in any country, especially when we have at our own fingertips Facebook, Twitter, all of these things. Good Catholics, who are practicing their faith in Parliament, in political leadership. And you're going to need to stand up to the bullies in the European Union because they want to push abortion on Croatia, on every country in Europe. You are the democracy. You control Croatia. If the politicians are not respecting human rights, if they're hurting children, if they're not doing their job, they should not be in office. So.
Evo na kraju ovog izlaganja Lale Rose u Splitu zatekli smo i dva brata, prezivaju se Bartulica, jedan nam je poznat, Stjepo Bartulica. Kako se vas doimio ovaj događaj, izlaganje Lale Rose, njoj je dosta bilo naporno?
Da, pa uvijek mi je drago biti u Splitu i vlada uvijek jedno posebno raspoloženje. Mi ne bježimo od pa i teških tema. Lajla je bila izvrsna, ona je strastvena žena, predana u borbi za život i veselimo se što smo mogli ovdje biti večeras.
Hoće li ovaj duh Lajle zaživjeti ovdje u Hrvatskoj? Imamo li mi naših hrvatskih Lajla dovoljno da uistinu nešto učinimo, da ne ostane sve ovo ovdje samo u ovoj dvorani?
Pa ja vjerujem u naše mlade ljude, tako da ne znam što će se dogoditi, vrijeme će pokazati, ali mislim i nadam se da iz ovoga će puno dobroga se dogoditi, da će ona nadahnuti pogotovo mlade ljude.
Imate li vi kakvog utjecaja na politiku? Ja sam čula da ste savjetnik našeg predsjednika.
To trebate njega pitati. Ja svjedočim koliko mogu i radim po savjesti.
Imate nekakvih planova što bi se još ovdje moglo u Hrvatskoj? Mislim da vi spadate u tu takozvanu konzervativnu Hrvatskoj koju svi govore, koja se budi.
Pa, da, mislim, To će vrijeme pokazati. Ja sam iznimno zahvalan i sretan što mnogi ljudi nam izlaze u susret i spremni su na suradnju, pogotovo mladi. Znači, nama je najviše stalo do njih. Bez njihovog angažmana bit će svima zapravo teško, a moglo bi biti i bolje. Oni su pozvani zapravo, a mi možemo samo dati primjer.
Zajedno ćemo braniti ljudski život od začeća. Vaš brat, svećenik, odrastao u USA. Gdje točno živite, djelujete, radite?
Živim u Kansas City, u biskupiji Kansas City. Tako imam dvije župe u Americi. Rado dođem u Hrvatsku koliko god mogu. Bio sam sve skupa, mislim, 8 godina živio u Hrvatskoj, u Zagrebu. Nažalost, nisam dovoljno dugo živio u Splitu.
Gdje ste naučili hrvatski jezik?
Pa naučio sam kod kuća u klasičnoj gimnaziji koju sam završio u Zagrebu. Nadam se da sam usavršio, nisam se nikada riješio američkog naglaska. Ja kažem, svi Hrvati imaju po neki naglasak, je to zagrebački ili splitski, pa ja imam američki. Tako.
Kako to da ste se vi koji ste odrasli u Sjedinjenim Američkim Državama odlučili za svećenika? To vas pitam jer stalno percipiramo Sjedinjene Američke Države kao nekakvo društvo zapadno u kojem je zapravo i teže živjeti ove kršćanske vrijednosti. Jesam li u pravu, u krivu?
Pa teško je živjeti, ali evo što je Laila rekla večeras, mislim da je vrlo važno znati da evo Amerikanci su počeli pričati o ovoj temi. Nažalost, u Hrvatskoj se ne govori o ovom, nažalost. I to pitanje života, što bi naravno u jednoj katoličkoj zemlji, što bi to trebalo biti potpuno neprihvatljivo, nikom ništa, jel? A u Americi barem ljudi ono nešto čine i pokrenuli su nešto, pa evo nekad pitali ste brata za ono kako to je on angažiran. Mislim da ima dosta Hrvata sad koji se vraćaju iz Amerike ili koji su tako možda došli iz dijaspore, koji mogu poticati Hrvate koji su ovdje, što mi možemo učiniti da naša domovina bude bolja.
Vjerujemo da će biti bolja. Sudjelujete li i vi u onom hodu za život March for Life?
Bio sam više puta na tome, ne idem svake godine, ali bilo bi lijepo da to jednom imamo u Hrvatskoj.
Na primjer, odakle da se krene, gdje da se ide?
Pa dobro, to je bude u glavnom gradu u Americi. March for Life budu i manifestacije po svim gradovima u Americi. To je ko po glavnim ulicama. Nažalost, prihvaćamo po našim gradovima da se neki koji imaju, da marširaju, imaju svoje parade nekakve za neke čudne vrijednosti, to je za stvari koje uopće nisu vrijednosti, a katolici uopće ne idu na to da bi mi marširali, to jest da bi imali neki događaj za život, da bi ljude potakli na nešto bolje.
Jesi, mi to bojimo možda, nekoga, nečega, što je naš problem?
Da, Sveti Ivan Pavao II. Je rekao na početku svog mandata, ne bojte se, rekao nam je. Mislim da se ljudi, ne znam zašto se boje, ne znam čega se to boje, mislim da bi se, jedna je velika kršćanska vrijednost i zapravo milost sakramenta potvrde, je to da se bojimo Boga. Jel, i nažalost, ljudi se boje nekih ideja u ovom svijetu ili nešto, a Boga se ne bojimo. Što će Bog misli na to što mi ništa ne činimo da branimo našu djecu, to jest za nerođene, a tako smo, mislim da se Boga trebamo, samo se Boga trebamo bojati, nikog drugog.
Jesu li katolici manjina u Sjedinjenim Američkim Državama?
Jesu, mislim da je oko 25-30% katolika. Nažalost, je taj broj sve manji jer ima sve više onih koji su otpali od katoličke crkve. To je više od 10% Amerikanaca danas su zapravo se smatraju bivšim katolicima. Taj broj što Hrvati vole citirati da je 90% katolika u Hrvatskoj, ja bih prije rekao da je možda 50 i 40 su oni koji se vole tako nazivati, a zapravo ništa ne čine da svoju vjeru žive.
Što je po vama razlog otpadu od katoličanstva? O tome se dosta razgovara, a mislim da su Amerikanci koji jesu katolici dosta aktivni, imaju svoje medije i televizije, oni dosta govore o tome što je uzrok zapravo otpadu nekih vjernika iz katoličke crkve.
Mislim da bi mogli govore sad, trebali bi sjesti možda 2-3 sata.
Neki kažu da su počeli previše oponašati protestante, pa su nekako izgubili svoj identitet, imali tome?
Ja bih rekao da ima dosta u tome i nažalost čujem da se i to uvuklo u Hrvatskoj u nekim u načinu kako mi živimo svoju vjeru, kako slavimo Euharistiju i kako što mislimo o tome, je li prihvaćamo sve što crkva naučava ili prihvaćamo samo dijelove. I čim ljudi žele promijeniti taj stav, joj pa znate, čuo sam nedavno da je postoje razne hereze u crkvi i tako dalje, a baš jedno u tome da prihvaćamo, želimo Isusa, a ne želimo crkvu. A nema Isusa bez crkve i crkvene nauke.
A kako ste vi tako sigurni u to, evo, odlučili ste život dati za Krista i njegovu crkvu?
Pa mislim da bi svi, svako na svoj način i laici isto treba, čuli smo od Lajle, ona to živi ko laikinja na pravi način i svećenici bi isto to trebali, ali sa svećeničke strane.
Vi nju pratite ovdje dok je u Hrvatskoj, bili ste u Međugorju, služili ste misu, tako je i započela ovaj ovdje nastup u Splitu. Čini se dosta pobožna, bila je ovako jedna zanimljiva misa. Primijetila sam da je kleknula na pričesti i svi vjernici koji su tad bili su se pričestili klečeći.
Mislim da je Papa Benedikt XVI je govorio prije, mislim, 7-8 godina da je kršćanin katolik, da jedino kleči pred Kristom. I tako kad primamo pričest znamo da samog Isusa primamo i način na koji ćemo ga primiti je baš to možemo u primanju Euharistije, da li to klečimo ili na koji način ga primimo, da i zaista vjerujemo da je on Bog među nama i na taj način ćemo zaista pokazati svoju vjeru.
Mi katolici vjerujemo u živog Isusa Krista u Euharistiji, on za nas nije samo ideja. Hvala vam lijepa, puno
Hvala
uspjeha
vam.
Dalje u evangelizaciji SAD-a.
Svakako je bilo vrlo poticajno svjedočanstvo i inspirativno je gledat mladu osobu kao mi, možda godina koja se na takav način odvažila boriti. I mislim da će njen događaj sigurno ostati u našim glavama i mislima i da ćemo biti još odvažniji u toj borbi za život, barem onako kako možemo u svojim sredinama, dizanjem svog glasa, udruživanjem, dijeljenjem letaka i tako.
Je li istina da se mi katolici malo ovako bojimo, ipak volimo ostati u svojoj intimi, malo nam je neugodno javno se izlagati?
Pa mislim da je istina, ali ovakvi posjeti su svakako dobro došli za ohrabrenje. Nekako posebno mi je drago što se više počinje pričati, pa makar i ovako polemizirati, jer jednostavno treba o tom pričati.
Evo, jedan momak iz Mravinaca slušao je Lajlu, što on kao jedan mlad muškarac kaže na ovu temu.
Evo, sad sam je zapravo drugi put slušao i drago mi je da sam bio u Zagrebu na ovom Cool Festu, jer sad smo bili u tehničkoj organizaciji, pa sam sad malo manje bio koncentriran. Ali svakako mislim da je hvale vrijedno što su to organizirali Vigilare i Cok u Zagrebu, to skad se priskočio, mi smo tek saznali u petak na tek potvrđeno da ona dolazi tu, pa smo eto na brzinu se snašli to se organizirati. Naša generacija možda još toliko o tome ne razmišlja, ne promišlja, ona već od 9. godine se bavi s tim temama, ali stvarno zaštiti života od začeća do smrti, svi smo orijentirani na rođenje i na sva moguća ljudska prava, ali ta kultura smrti se stvarno širi i eto kako smo čuli komentare, ni u našem saboru nemamo jakih zagovornika zaštite od samog začeća i ti neki lobiji koji pritišću, stvarno mi mladi moramo biti ovo što ste rekli, da katolici su stvarno nekako srame i društveno djelovati, ovakve stvari organizirati, nekako dišpet svoj pokazati i svoje kršćanstvo staviti u društveno djelovanje, tako nekako, kako reći, i političko i sve ne bježati od tih nekih, kao to je sve, ne znam, prljavo, mi ćemo se zatvoriti, što ste vi rekli, u svojim timu, u crkve i ne izlaziti vani.